Everybody is playing it extremely safe now, aren't they? I'm doing the opposite. Just letting go, letting go, just putting it all out there. Did that yesterday till 3 o'clock in the morning. I was working all these graphics. I believe I posted a video. I did all those graphics in one day. Put it all together, all that stuff, and posted it on Facebook plus commentary in one day. Started, you know, early in the morning, went till 3 o'clock in the morning. Put it all out there. And it doesn't matter, you know, there's very, almost no reaction whatsoever. And I thank those who did take a look at the graphics. There's a lot of very intense, focused effort there. Probably the greatest output I've ever done in a single day. Plus the 2.5 hour video, plus, you know, doing a slideshow of the graphics I did. Everything, all in one day. So I'm just, you know, putting it all out there, but everybody else seems to be playing it very safe in the world. People, most of us are playing it very, very, very safe. It's not a time to play it safe. How do you think Tiger Woods won all those golf tournaments? Everybody else is tightening up. Oh, Tiger Woods says, hey, no way, you know. I'm just letting it go, man. I'm just letting it go. And he says to gain control, you have to let go of control. Great advice, isn't it? I was just tracking my golf swing there. It's just better than ever. It's like, wow. Wow. I haven't hit a golf ball in 4 months, probably. But just working out, getting stronger and stronger, more and more flexible. And you just, you know, you have to let it go. So that's very few have the confidence to do that because they haven't prepared. So they're tightening up right now. A lot of trouble. Philippines, of course, you have a reformer there, Duterte, is rocking the country. Wow, it's going to be, reform is a rocky road. Here in the United States, you have a reformer, Trump, who's running for president. And, you know, if he's elected, it's going to be a rocky road in terms of, reform is a rocky road. It just depends, you know, what the people want. They just want to play it status quo and just keep on, you know, play it safe and status quo. Well, this is always what's going on in the world. When you status quo, it's let the corruption continue, basically. And this is one ideology. Well, on the spiritual path, our corruption is laziness, okay? It really is laziness. And so, throughout history, the three jewels of Buddhism, for instance, the teacher, the teaching, and the community of those who are helping get the teaching out to the world, what you do is you give those who are interested in liberation, you give them their marching orders is they have to spread the gospel. It's Christianity. Jesus gave the apostles the marching orders, go out there and start spreading the gospel. He gave that orders to many. And why do they always do this? Because as you try to help others, you are helped. Because it requires commitment, focus on the truth in your own life if you want to help others. So if I'm sitting down and make this video, I realize, hey, I have got to be, you know, on point. I have to bring the goods. If you do those graphics, you put them out to the world. You got to try and do it right. And you know, it really requires a 360-degree commitment on your part to try and help spread the Dharma, spread the gospel. Same Dharma, gospel, same thing. Gospel, good news. Dharma is really the good news of liberation from transmigration. So the best advice is to contribute, which is what I've been doing my whole life. I'm just always trying to contribute. And yeah, the audience is very small. The audience hasn't happened as far as any sort of critical acclaim or anything like that. But what's happened is the fruit on my tree has ripened, you know. It's ripe, very ripe. Because that's the fertilizer. I keep putting fertilizer. I guess I'm spreading fertilizer everywhere and some of it falls on my tree. But in order to, you know, to do this, it's like you are the fertilizer. You become the fertilizer of your own path. In order to fertilize others, you have to be fertilizer. And as you are fertilizer, that fertilizes and intrinsically fertilizes your own clarity. And most just are playing it safe. I want to be spoon-fed. And I don't want to, you know, stick, you know, nail. I don't want to be a nail sticking up because there's a lot of hammers in the world right now. Well, that's true. But when you play it safe, you lose. Get hammered down. Whereas if you go for it, There's the nails. It's a different story. It's a different story. The nail's not even there. The search isn't even there. So along the way, I've been befriended by these Dharma kings because they like this. They like the effort. That's what they're looking for. We think they're looking for devotees. No, they're looking for those who are serious about it. And who are so serious that they're trying to help others, they're trying to always clarify, they're trying to, spread the gospel, spread the Dharma. Jesus said, if you don't speak up and help spread the gospel, I don't know you. Because he's telling them, look, this is how you get to know me, is by helping others get to know me. Now, it's pretty difficult to do this right now, isn't it? Facebook's one way. Every little thing I say in the world, if I actually say it to something, they don't like it. Everybody is playing it very safe right now, and I'm very iconoclastic. I try not to play it safe. The safer that everyone's play it, the less safe I tend to play it. You don't want to get petrified at this point, but most of us are already petrified. Okay, so we to start our practice always with the humility, is that I'm an idiot, I'm a fool, I'm lazy, I'm stuck in continuity fear. Okay, basically, I'm just, you lump it all together and say, we just say, I have one problem and one problem only. No other problems exist. I don't have any other problem. I have just one problem, that's continuity fear, but it's a very, 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 very severe problem. Okay. And I suggest anyone that's in this world should practice the wow practice with humility, even the bodhisattvas that are here, right? Absolutely. Because this world is an effort to defamiliarize ourselves with reality. It's an extreme effort, actually. And just being here, it can easily, like a snake, creep up on you in some way. It creeps up on you. It'll creep up on you here. You don't see these Dharma kings, and they stop meditating. They say, "Oh, okay, I gotta stop meditating," or, "I'm gonna stop." No, they continued their, whatever they did. They stayed very much involved in setting a good example. So I think everyone should practice in this way. Doesn't matter how high you are, how low you are, should practice with humility that a shock could come to me, a shock of recognition. And it's like, oh my gosh, I should have seen that before. Why didn't I see that before? It's so obvious. Wow. Completely obvious. Holy cow. And the whole path is that way. Is you see something, you say, but that's easy. That can't be it, really? No, we're trying to overlook what is simple and true through complexity. So of course, when we see truth, it's going to be simple and easy. Of course, but the shock is, so wait a minute. Well, how come I didn't see that? So it's always shocking to us. It's always shocking. And we should expect, as long as we're in this world, we're probably going to continue to have these shocks of recognition. Don't anyone rest on your laurels. Don't rest on your laurels. That's a bad idea. Every day we make an effort. Okay, let's go. Let's push beyond the wall of our expectations here and see what happens. Just see what happens. So I've been fortunate to be befriended by these Dharma kings, and taking me under their wing, elder brothers and sisters kind of thing. And this is helpful. I guess that's critical acclaim. They're the best critics, but popular acclaim. No popular. Maybe I've gotten critical acclaim, but no popular acclaim. Let's put it that way. Critical success, but a populist failure. But again, that's how it goes for us, because again, the real purpose is for us to try to help. It's like if you want to be a golf instructor, you have to work on your own swing, don't you? Yeah, you might say, "I'm a golf instructor, folks," and your swing's terrible, and people say, "What?" So here I am working, working, working. My swing gets better and better and better and better and better. And I could tell people, "Look, that this is how you want to ultimately swing the golf club." with some power to it, some speed to it. You know, I mean, to turn the shoulders, get past parallel. I mean, just, you know, really torque it. And wide arc, wide arc, widen your arc. You know, keep widening your arc. Widen your turn, widen your arc, delay your release. Okay, this is how you do it. And you just keep working on that, widening your arc, increasing your turn, and delaying your release. So it's just the release comes late, but it just whips through at the very last. You just keep working on that, working on that, working on that. And your swing will get more and more and more and more powerful. It's the same way with the spiritual practice. You just keep working on the basics. When golf swing, it would be flexibility, and then core strength, and cross training strength, and all your muscles too. And as I said, flexibility to turn. So you work on your flexibility, your core strength, and your balance, and your coordination, basically. These are the areas. And of course, your confidence. So they're just these key elements that the stronger all those elements get, the better the golf swing gets. The stronger in our practice the elements get, the better our practice gets. So yesterday was a day of just intense wow. The wow was so intense, just carried through to 3 in the morning. Today it's not quite as intense. I need a little, you know, a little break from that. I'm trying to pump up the volume as much as possible here. So we start out by admitting we have a terrible problem, continuity problem. It's such a terrible problem that we all have it. You see, we all have it. We wouldn't be here if we didn't have this problem, actually. If we didn't have a continuity fear problem, we'd be able to dissolve ourselves into light like Padmasambhava or Jesus did. We'd be able to do that right now. So if we can't do that right now, guess what? We have a continuity fear problem, a very severe one, actually. Because everything that gurus can do, and they can do just, you know, just about anything, you name it. If we can't do that, why? Because we have a severe continuity problem. Don't ever, ever say it's because they're superior to us. That's a lie. See, that's the lie of laziness that gets us and causes us transmigration into different realms, a constant moving through different realms. And we have to out this lie. The central lie is, oh no, I'm different. They're different. Jesus is different than us. He's God. He can do all this stuff, but we're just humans. We can't do it. That's the lie of the ego, the lie of the devil. Okay, the devil of arrogance. How dare we say that what God created equal is no longer equal? How dare we say that, right? Arrogance. So if we cannot be like Jesus right now, the only reason why is because of we have a very severe problem. It has to be very severe because Jesus is just functioning in a natural way that we're all supposed to function that way too. So if we're not functioning that way, we must have a, you know, drastic problem. And the drastic problem is the continuity fear problem. We've tried to forget what we are to such an extent that we can't quite remember what we are. And we're afraid, like, I don't know how I'll function at all. It's a fear of what we are, not knowing how to be that way. We've tried to imagine we're something else. So it's a terrible, severe problem, but it's the only problem we have. Therefore, all our efforts should be designed to evaporate this continuity problem. Don't focus on other problems, really. I try not to. So now let us talk about what people would say is meditation, what we call full stop in the wow. And you find throughout history that those who are really into liberation, they get the grace of God helps them see how to practice properly. And so it's not any surprise that we have this practice now. And if you go back through history, you realize, oh, this is quite similar to other practices. I didn't know that when this practice was suggested and I developed it for the Holy Grace of God, Holy Spirit. I said, well, this has been my experience. I can see, organically, I can see from how all the struggle I've been through that this is what works. And then recently I've seen that throughout history of spiritual practice, this is the basic practice that actually works. You can call it many different names, whatever names you like, but it's the same. And there is an art to it. There's an art to it. It's not a science, so I cannot just say do this. The art of it escapes when we try to do that. So we just have to, in your own life, you have to continue to keep trying, and perhaps this will help you out a little bit. Maybe not as much as you would like, but at least the encouragement. It's because you think that you have to grasp it, and you think once you got it, then you can stop. Say, okay, I got like I got a material thing. I don't have to go out and get it anymore. I've got it. It's not like that. You have to do it every day, and every day you have to find a way to get into this practice. And the resistances are different every day. So it's really determination and then confidence. You have to build your confidence through daily practice. Confidence has a lot to do with it, actually. In this world, confidence is super important in this realm. So if you just feel, I'm sure I can, I know I can do it, I've done it so many times, that breaks through all these barriers. And you don't get all hung up and start doubting yourself. Say, no, I don't doubt myself at all. I know I'm going to get it. There's no question about it. I've done it thousands and thousands of times. I'll get it this time also. And then that's, just pushes all these doubts away, doesn't it? Just pushes these doubts away. This is why gurus are helpful, is they say, look, I know I can keep functioning this way because I've been doing this for so long. And they have this confidence, like a snowplow, just plows all the snow, the icy cold away, that locks us up into fear, like, I can't do it, I can't do it, I'm not sure I can do it. Those thoughts are not going through my head as far as, I can't do it, how can I do this? No, I know I'm going to do it. Okay. Most of the time. There's sometimes that it's kind of like this morning. It's like, wow. I had to wow it. I had to just say, okay, the problem I'm having this morning is just the wow is still there. And so just be patient. I went through such an intense day yesterday. It's still here. The wow is still here. So I didn't lose wisdom or anything. It's just the wow has temporarily obscured it. I'm stunned by the progress I made. So you have to keep this in mind. When you're on the path, the number one obstacle is the progress you make. It's not the failure of progress, it's the amazing progress you make. The progress you make stuns you. So this is a completely different paradigm than the world where we get stunned by the failure, constant failure, and we're desperately trying to adapt to failure. Gosh, this failure keeps bothering me. And if you go down that path, you go down the path of the politicians want you to go down. You're trying to get used to failure. You're trying to adjust and acclimatize to failure. And of course, then, if the more you do that, the more you fear dropping failure. The more difficult it becomes, isn't it? You say, but I'm so used to it. I'm so used to failure. How can I drop it? So that's why you have to start practicing, paying attention, and being willing to wow success. There's no other way. We're so used to failure. Success comes to us as an enormous shock to us. Even little success, enormous shock. So I've had so much success on the path, but it's come bit by bit. Each time, it's been very shocking for me, quite shocking. And so don't think that you can just jump into, massive success. It doesn't work that way. Theoretically, you can, but you'll be too shocked by it. And then you'll retreat. You don't want to retreat. So you want enough success to shock you, but not enough to panic you into retreat. So this is part of the art of it. And the Holy Spirit knows all this. So one of Ramana's key phrases, I use it, is trust it. It's one of the best phrases that I've ever heard. One of the most important phrases. trust it. Trust it. Trust it. Got to trust it. Got to trust it. Got to trust it. That you will not get too much. Now, you can really push it, but you can still handle it with the wow. The better you are at the wow, the better, the more you can push it. It's like if you got real strong legs, you can take a really tough hike. Whereas if your legs are weak and you try to take that tough hike, you may not be able to get down the mountain. That almost happened to me a couple of days ago. I said, I'm not sure I'm able to get down this mountain. It was like, wow. That was a big wow. I never experienced that before. So I got down, but boy, was I. I said, oh boy, I'm glad I'm down that mountain. So that was a bit of a misunderstanding. I was looking for some landmark and I never found it. So I kept going, 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 going. But it worked out okay. Yeah, I really pushed it. So you could push it, but don't push it too much. Don't push it too much. That's why I say don't use drugs. Don't use stimulants. Don't use enticements of the flesh on the spiritual path, because that can easily cause you to push it too much, and then that leads to you know, like if I couldn't get down the mountain, I would have been like a crisis, you see. And then you say, I can't trust the path. I can't trust it. So the ego tries to drive you into a crisis. It says, no, go, you know, push it even more. Push it even, you know, keep pushing, push. Here, we push it, but it's always in the context of the wow, of our practice. We don't push it outside this context. I don't advise anybody to push the spiritual path outside of this context. If they do, they're on their own. They're on their own. Okay, don't blame me for that. I'm saying all spiritual practice should be within this context of full stop in the wow, that you go into it knowing you're going to be stunned by your success and willing to pay that price. The patience you need, willing to pay that price. And no other context do I endorse. Okay, no other context do I endorse. There's a million other ways that people try. I don't endorse any of them. Okay, through long experience in looking at the entire situation here, which is, you know, which is what has happened, I don't endorse any other path. All our practice has to start out with the awareness that whatever success comes, it will shock us. It truly will. But if we play the role of the poser, like, oh yeah, well, no, that's not a big deal for me. You know, yeah, okay. We're in big trouble. We're in big trouble. That's not the path. That's not the path. So never play that role. Always be the humble meek, as Jesus said. The poor in spirit shall inherit the kingdom of heaven. Meaning, when you practice, always be the meek, the humble. Expect you're going to be stunned, and don't play the role of saying, nothing can stun me. Nothing can stun me. No. I can do whatever I want to do, you know. There can't be anything that can possibly. Oh yes, there can. Oh yes, there can. So this is the safe way. This is the way that works. And getting endorsements from these Dharma kings has been huge. It's enabled me to keep it going. The first endorsement I got, well, of course, Jesus, with A Course in Miracles, endorsed that to me in saying, you know, go fast, go fast, go fast. Don't get hung up in you know, the words, you know, absorb it, absorb it, absorb it. He's always pushing. But as far as the endorsement, you can, you know, go on from that. You got Rana Maharshi, who said, keep doing what you're doing. Keep doing what you're doing. It's going to be very, very successful and helpful. So that is a super great, and that saved me. It saved me. And then other Dharma kings have come along. Longchenpa came along. Padmasambhava has now come along. Sri Sri Nanmai Ma, Jamyang Khyentse Chogyi Lodro. All of them have come along and given an endorsement to this. They've endorsed it because they know this is how they also see, and this is where it's come from. From their experience, they know that success stuns us very badly. And if we don't know how to manage our success, there's no way we're going to succeed. There's no pragmatic way. There's a theoretical way, but then you end up stalling out at some point, and then claiming your stall out is enlightenment or something, right? It's not. So I advocate to everyone to practice in this way. And I feel confident in doing so because the Dharma Kings have shown up and endorsed me, knowing that this is what I advocate. They wouldn't have endorsed me if they said, no, what you're advocating is you know, wrong. No, of course not. You practice with this mood of repentance, humble attitude, meek, humble, realizing you're going to be stunned. You're going to be shocked by the success that you have, that comes to you. The last will be first and the first will be last, as Jesus said. Meaning, those who try to be posers, like, wow, nothing can shock me. They'll be the last ones to enter the kingdom. Those who practice in a meek, humble way, like the lowly way, like, I'm sure that whatever comes up is really going to rock my whole realm of expectation severely. So I'm going to practice and be in that way. So I'm going to already be in a humble, meek mood. So when I get shocked, there won't be a continuity problem. So do you get what we're saying here? When we say our problem is the continuity problem, continuity fear, this is the only problem we have, and it's very severe. Now, if we're posing like know-it-alls, and then we get shocked by some realization that comes, there's a severe continuity fear between how we present ourselves to the world and how we're feeling inside. And so this will feel like a great threat to us. It'll threaten our whole 360-degree realm of expectations, right? And then you'll back off the insight and rationalize your backing away. Whereas if we approach the insight by being meek and lowly and humble, like, hey, I'm somebody with a severe problem here, you know, then when the shock of success hits us, how do we feel? We feel kind of meek and humbly and lowly, like, wow, I'm really not, you know, I'm shocked by this. But there's no continuity problem then, is there? Because we were already adapted this lowly kind of position in our practicing. It's smooth. Say, okay, I'm really shocked. I'm kind of walking around like I'm really shocked. And that's how I generally walk around, pretty much, is meek and humble and lowly and in a mood of repentance. And so my expectations are not rocked at all, hardly at all. But, of course, they are being rocked, but I'm already in that mode of expecting that. So, oh yeah, okay, so another day, all my expectations, the whole landscape of my expectations just shifted again. Well, guess what? They shifted yesterday and the day before and the day before and the day before. And so I kind of really don't know what to do, right? Yeah. So this feeling like I really don't know what to do with myself is this lowly, meek, humble mode that is so important. Because when we get these breakthroughs, for a while, we won't know what to do with ourselves. We'll just like say, oh my gosh, how do I, everything has changed. I don't know what to do. And if that's the mode that you're normally in, and then you'll just say, oh, okay, business as usual. It's okay. I'll just let this settle down. Just let it settle down. And so you don't have this continuity fear problem. It evaporates it, see? This is the greatness of this approach. Then it's how we smooth out and evaporate our continuity fear problem. So it's super important every day to spend time just feeling like you've just been knocked out. Basically, I spend most of my time in my life that way, that I've just been knocked out, really knocked out. A little bit woozy, you know, just like, what? But knocked out in a positive way. Something just knocked me out. So if we can contribute stuff that knocks each other out, this is a great, great help to us. And so these graphics I make, I'm making them to try to knock everybody out. Of course, I'm knocking myself out. I made a graphic like yesterday that just knocked me out. Shri Shri Anandamayi, I put this flower frame. I did this rendering of her with uses like words to fill in actually the picture of somebody is replaced with these lines of text and stuff, and it makes it look like you can still see the person there, kind of, but it's all these words, bliss, clarity, peace, and all those things I used. And so there was a picture of there just using words, a word picture like that. And I put it into this beautiful flower flame, a new one I found. And it just absolutely, I mean, my head was on the desk, on the computer. I just said, wow. It's funny, nobody commented on that picture. They all ignored it because it's a knockout. And so it's easy for me to tell what's going on in the world. People don't want to be knocked out because they're so pressured to perform in a super efficient, effective way, in the world, that they have to bluff. A lot of their lives is bluffing, bluffing confidence. Sure, I'm confident in that. Sure, of course I am, and live up to these real high expectations. So they can't feel, they can't afford to be shocked and knocked out like this, because people say, what's wrong with you? You okay? You're sick? Might better get a day's rest and come back, And so they're afraid to be knocked out. This is what I've discovered. They're afraid to be knocked out. Me, I live to be knocked out in this way. Nobody has any high expectations of me. This is a super advantage in life. This is why I say to be born poor and humble, where no one expects anything of you, is the greatest advantage on the spiritual path, actually. It's the greatest advantage. So I'm super blessed in that way, that somehow I was able to slip through the cracks. And nobody expects anything other than me than just maybe a little bit of sports talk or something. That's about it. And even that, I don't even know what I'm talking about anymore. Although I know that Lincecum got demoted to the minors, or at least they DFA'd. What am I going to do with the Freak Is Back t-shirt? Come on, Timmy. God, now it's like probably really valuable, huh? The shirt. Yeah, it's like, oh man, that was like a moment in time, Oh, that popped up on my Facebook news on the news thing. Is Tim Lincecum demoted to the DFA, designated for assignment? What? Oh man, the rock star, is in rehab. The rock star's in rehab. Are you kidding me? Well, very humbling, isn't it? Just think of the expectations he's had to live with. It's brutal. It's brutal. He is one of the best college pitchers in the history of collegiate baseball, for sure. He was named to the Pac-12 100-year all-time team as one of the starting pitchers, along with people like Mark Pryor and some other ones that are just great collegiate pitchers. He's one of them. He's the all-time Pac-12 strikeout leader in the history of the conference. All-time University of Washington baseball team. Starting pitcher on their all-time team. He was the Collegiate Player of the Year, Silver Spikes Award winner. So he's like one of the greatest college pitchers in the history of the game. And then he came in his first two full seasons, Cy Young Awards both times, and then the next two seasons, very close to winning it. The greatest start of any history, pitcher in history. Three consecutive strikeout crowns his first three full years. Two no-hitters, three world championships. I mean, he's one of the best pitchers in the history of baseball, really. But it didn't last very long enough. It didn't last very long enough. So, one of the best college pitchers of all time, one of the best major league pitchers of all time. And people have these expectations for you. And his body, it didn't hold up. So he's under the weight of all these expectations. It's horrible to live that way, isn't it? But for me, I never had any accomplishments at all, which is very frustrating. I was overlooked, continuously overlooked. Even there's someone told me when I was young. He said, "Hey, look, I've been watching you. I noticed you." He said, "Look, nobody knows what you're doing. I see what you're doing. Nobody else. They all overlook it. That's crazy." And I said, "Yeah, I know. I know. It's like really weird." I said, "Thanks for saying that, because it was very. It's like I'm not even there." So I didn't understand what was going on. I said, "God's trying to punish me. God hates me. God's forsaken me." No, just the opposite. Just the opposite. God was saying, "Look, I want to make you meek and humble and take all expectations off of your shoulders, so you can be truly stunned by the success on the spiritual path." and this is how you will succeed. And I didn't understand that. You know, it's very difficult to understand that, but I'm trying to help others who are going through this to understand this, how you maybe just be overlooked in every possible way and end up on a very low position like I have, like the bottom of the barrel position in life. But I get up in the morning and it's like, hey, I can afford to be knocked out all day. Not on drugs, not on sex, drugs, and rock and roll, but knocked out on spiritual breakthroughs. Okay, all day I can just be, wow. Yeah, people maybe think I'm on drugs. I'm kind of like, wow. You know, I don't do it that. No, I just act normal. But I don't seem like very talkative a lot of times in public, or you know, just kind of a nothing, because my mind. I'm in the shock of like the this morning. I had this massive breakthrough, and I'm in the shock of this great breakthrough I had this morning, and I just seem like I'm kind of a little bit out of it. You know, he's not too bright. You know, he's just doesn't have much to say. He's not really with it. Nah, nothing to see there. Oh, thank you very much. Nothing to see there. And then if I do talk, they're kind of like, what? What are you talking about? I mean, who do you think? What? Then it's a continuity freak out for them, because they expect me to be a certain way. And if I start being real smart, they say, well, what are you trying to be? You're, you know, trying to be smart or something? You know, what are you? So you do get pigeonholed, kind of, by that way, which is to say that those in your own family and so close social friends, they're the last to accept that you might have been made, you know, the breakthrough and freed from transmigration, because you've been very meek and lowly and humble as far as they're concerned, because that's what they've seen. Well, that's what's the advantage. That's the super advantage. So God has given me like a super advantage. But I thought he was, you know, God was like persecuting me or something. Or I didn't know what. I didn't know what to think, really. I was confused. I said, I don't know. I don't understand what's going on. I thought you wanted help, and yet you keep pulling the rug out from underneath me. And what's going on? That's what's going on. It's actually greatly helping us when this occurs. Greatly helping us. It's funny. No matter what I do, I put out almost 100 graphics yesterday, and other than the few regulars, there's a nobody, you know, remarked, liked, nothing. There's nothing, no feedback, zero. It's like, wow. Tough audience, huh? It's like you tell jokes and they all fall flat. And you say, man, my material is just as good as other. They get all the laughs and I don't get nothing. Well, it's God blocking it all for you. So you don't feel you need to be on point in that way. Now I can talk here even when I'm in the wow, because we're talking about the wow. You see, I'm talking about the wow, but I can't talk to others in my life about the wow. They have no idea what I'm talking about. But those on the spiritual path understand what I'm saying, right? Is how do you smooth out your path? This continuity problem stalls you out, and this is how we do it. So again, when we're shocked by a great spiritual breakthrough, when there are many, many great breakthroughs that occur, it stuns us very severely. And our landscape of our expectations has suddenly completely shifted. Everything's different. I said, so what am I going to do with my life? I don't know. And so we feel, you know, this, I'm not sure, you know, I'm not really sure what I'm doing with my life, like a you know, a junior in high school or a freshman in college. It's like, you know, what are you going to do? I don't really know what I'm going to do with my life. I met one of my cousin's children recently, and I asked her, are you in school? She goes, yeah, well, no, right now. I went 3 years, but then I stopped because I don't really know what I want to do. And her mom said, yeah, she's one of those, you know, she's not really sure what she wants to do. And I said, well, guess what? I've been that way my whole life, and it's working out great for me. So, you know, I'm with you on that. And she's like, wow, that was really cool to hear that from some adult, you know. It was like a moment for her that somebody didn't try to push her into, well, you need to, what do you want to do? I just said, hey, you know, sometimes not knowing what you want to do, maybe that's the best thing for you. Maybe that's the best thing for you. And so she kind of, I felt like, you know, I got some, there's maybe some, you know, gratitude for hearing that viewpoint, because really sometimes it is the very best thing for you. I've never known what I'm going to do in life, because every day the whole landscape shifts on me. Okay, I thought I'm going to do this. Now, wait a minute. I just met Padmasambhava. Okay. Well, that just changes everything. Wait a minute. Yesterday, and today, it's complete. I have no idea how to structure my future. And this is often, young people, they just don't know. And then people look at them like, oh, okay, they're struggling in life, and they'll figure it out. So I feel like a perpetual teenager in life, which I am. I can't figure it out because it keeps shifting on me. But in better ways, like, holy cow, I'm a friend of Padmasambhava. How am I going to function now? I don't know. I don't know what the expectations are. I don't know the landscape of expectations. It's like, oh my gosh, Longchenpa. I met Longchenpa. I'm buddies. I'm friends with Longchenpa. What does that mean for my life? I don't know. But I know it's completely changed, isn't it? Completely changed. So if we got a job that we're supposed to, we're a diva, a work diva, we're going to avoid these breakthroughs. That there's the last thing we want. It scares the heck out of us because, people look up to us to set an example of like what a great work diva in terms of, I'm never stunned. Nothing stuns me. This is the thing. If you want to be president, just act like nothing ever stuns you. How could you make progress in the spiritual path? What kind of example is that setting for the nation? Terrible example. You should be able to say, wow, I didn't know that. I'm stunned. Wow. I'm just going to sit down here and let's have a moment together here, and let's all just realize that all our expectations have just shifted, and let's take a no. But the people who are present, says, no problem. I know exactly what to do. This is a bluff. This is a faker. This is a poser. Okay, these are posers. Don't follow posers. They're fakers. They'll lead you into hell. Okay, we're already into hell. They'll lead you with more momentum with your transmigrations, which is hell. So, transmigrations is hell, but what we say, the worst hell is to have a lot of momentum in your transmigrations, wandering through realms. The more momentum you have, the more difficult it is to be liberated from it. So you don't want those who build up that sort of momentum. You want those who will say, hey, let's just stop here for a moment, because our expectations have just suddenly really shifted here. Okay? And so we're all just going to take a breather. We're all going to take a break. And I'm not going to ask you to do anything at all, except just sit quietly. And don't try to make any impression upon the world with your, look how competent I am. I know what the expectations are. I mean, I'm meeting my expectations. Don't try to impress the world, and don't try to impress yourself. Don't try to impress the world, or don't try to impress yourself at this point. You're free from both of those angles, you see. And this is real meditation. This is full stop in the wow. You're not trying to impress anyone, and including yourself. And you just, I'm a nobody. I'm a nothing right now. And that's okay. Because I just realized that we don't need to search for what we are. All this search does not need to be fulfilled in any way. So the whole thing, I can let everything exactly as it is right now, leave it, and shift all my attention to clear light perception of inherent spaciousness. That's all that's required. Now, doesn't that change our expectations? But we realize I don't need to do anything at all, except make this shift of attention, you might say. Yeah, doesn't that change our expectations of what we're going to be doing? Of course it does. It completely revolutionizes it, doesn't it? So it's this inner revolution is continuously going on. As Ramana and the teachers say, do the inner revolution. Forget about external revolutions. It's the internal revolution. It's your own revolution that you must pursue. And you keep winning and winning and winning. And my gosh, transforming, transforming, transforming. The whole landscape of your expectations is continuously being transformed. It's a workout. I did a little workout today with weights. That's a pretty good one. Just a little upper body workout. It's good. Maybe I'll do a little more today, upper body, letting the legs heal up a little bit to push it again, which is good. The legs are feeling pretty good, pretty strong. I'll go at it again You know, the days ahead, I'll try to do something. We'll see. You keep it going that way. So spiritual practice, you find a way to keep it going. That's, you have to be a genius, and you are a genius. We're all geniuses. And the Holy Spirit is the ultimate genius. I just ask the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, suggest something to me here. I got to keep it going today. I got to keep it going today. And you must have this desperation that you can't miss a day. You're desperate for that. He says, Holy Spirit, this is terrible. When I start missing, you know, starting to, the hours go by, I say, hey, I get desperate. I say, Holy Spirit, this is a disaster. You must help me now. You know, and you really, really start praying for help so that you don't waste a day. And so you start out, when that happens, start out with the wow. And recognize you're stalled out because of the wow. And then just then accept it. Meek, humble, and lowly, and just expect your expectations, right? You're not functioning so great. Great. That means you're in the wow. Great. So start with that success. Oh, the wow is part of my success, isn't it? Because I'm letting it settle down. It's settling down. And when it settles down, guess what? Your clarity is even better than before. Way better than before. Way better. And then just like exercise, if my legs are getting way stronger than before, our clarity becomes way better. And you just see that, oh, yeah, I can see that. Well, that's easy to see now. Just like a lake, the muddy waters are stirred up, and just let it settle. And every day it settles more. And one day you look at the lake and you can say, wow. Look, I can see the stones in the bottom of the lake there. I can see very clearly what's there. So Dzogchenpa, as your president, will allow you to practice full stop in the wow, which frees you from, ultimately, is the how to be freed from the agony of transmigration, the continual agony of it, the nonstop agony. So elect Dzogchenpa president. So, you know, as we say, not my president. These presidents that come, have been on the scene, they're not my, people say the president, they're not my president. That's for sure. Dzogchenpa is my president. I've already elected him president. In my life, Dzogchenpa is president. Formless, definition-free self, the true self, is president. And we use the term Dzogchenpa to remind ourselves that it involves practice on our part. So Dzogchenpa is going to advocate spiritual practice, right spiritual practice for us. So I suspect I'll have a role in Dzogchenpa's cabinet. In some way, as it may be, an ambassador to some country or something, right? I mean, how the president, there's a lot of positions to fill in administration, right? You look at it this way, spiritual administration, there's a lot of positions to fill. I expect that I have some role to play. So I have that in my mind. I'm going to have some role to play. I want to reflect well upon Dzogchenpa, so I keep working very intensely. So Dzogchenpa is my president. I don't follow political presidents anymore. I only follow spiritual presidents. Okay, because only they know how to liberate me from transmigration. That only they have that goal. They're already free. So if you have some leader that's not free from transmigration, guess what? It's impossible to not be free unless you're purposefully following transmigration. So their purpose must be transmigration. It must be. And if they're not advocating spiritual practice, then they're posers. Okay? Very bad posers. And they will not, this will be terrible to follow them, because you'll become a poser too, and then you'll be afraid to have spiritual breakthroughs, because it'll crumble your facade of like nothing phases me. Okay. Whereas what we say is we expect to be phased, and we welcome being phased. We welcome being knocked out. Completely different direction, isn't it? Completely different direction. I had problems with my dad growing up because he was a spiritual poser. He was very knowledgeable, but he was put, so much pressure was put on him by various, it was very unfortunate. People who wanted to use him as a figurehead told him that, you know, he was, you know, one of the great leaders of the New Age. But of course it was the Eminence Grease behind the scenes who like to control things from behind the scenes. There's always those controllers, puppet masters behind the scenes. They saw him as a very useful puppet to use. So they convinced him, or tried to convince him, that you know, he was one of, you know, he was one of the key players in the New Age movement, and he was going to usher in this great new spiritual age. So then that raised him up to a level where he always had to act like he was certain about everything. You know, the leader has to always know what to do. And the problem was, is that I would wow him. And he didn't know how to handle it. He got very upset because he'd have to appear like, oh yeah, that's this, and that's not, you know, nearly as much as I know, but that's nice, you know. Okay, that reminds me of a quote. Just kind of brush it aside. How leaders, CEOs, oh yeah, you're doing a good job. That's a nice job. They're a nice job. And I said, what do you mean a nice job? I just said something that just knocked you out. And he's acting like he's not knocked out at all. But when you're knocked out and you're acting like you're not knocked out, you start getting dictatorial and you start treating people in ways you shouldn't treat them. To, you know, start bullying them because you're having to pretend that you're not knocked out, so you overcompensate. So this is the trouble. So I have very firsthand experience in all of this. So I got into a lot of hot water and had a rough relationship because every time I opened my mouth, I said something, you know, that shocked him spiritually, and he liked that, but he couldn't, his role was such that he couldn't handle it properly. Very terrible, very regrettable, you know. So you don't want these eminent puppet masters running things unless they're the Dharmic kings, and they're not puppet masters. They understand this practice. They're advocates of it. They say, now we want you to be knocked out like this and wow. We want you sitting quietly. We don't want you to be, you know, someone who you know, just total joie de vivre, and you know, I'm the CEO and I'm just breezing. Great. It's fine to be that way some of the time, to express your confidence, but you always have to be primarily allowing the knockout blow to be landed on you. So don't, you know, stay low. Stay. So they've kept me very, very low, and humble. And not allowing me to be used as a figurehead. Those who get used as the figureheads goes very badly for them. Because the ones behind the scenes are just trying to control, you know, spiritual materialism. They're just trying to make the stall out, control the stall out and profit from it. And a lot of stuff. It's not good. It's the blind leading the blind. And they love these charismatic figureheads. My dad was super charismatic. Super charismatic, you know, leading man in Hollywood movie types. He was a leading man in Hollywood movie. People just thought, you know, he was just like wonderful. And then you start throwing a bunch of spiritual talk out there. They think, oh, it's a New Age Messiah kind of thing. And I would say, what? What are you talking about? You just said this. That's dualistic. You know, you didn't want anyone else to hear that, you know. Don't let anybody hear that you talk to me like that way. Nobody talks to me like that. I say, what are you talking? I'm your son. I can say what I want. No. I've got a facade I have to protect. This is a lot of us deal with successful parents. This is the problem. We end up having to protect their facade. So it's much better to be in a lowly position, very lowly. But of course, my dad helped me out in so many ways by allowing me to familiarize with so much here, spiritual stuff. But perhaps none of that really needs to be overly familiarized with. Because just call off the search. That's all we need to do. We just need to call off the search. There's nothing more. But people who are looking for to have a successful search, which is almost everyone here, they need these New Age guru messiahs to say, this is how we can successfully find the self. What? I said, what? What are you talking about? There is no successful search for the self. That's ridiculous. How can you search for what is everywhere? How can you have a successful search? How can you say it's successful, but all the while it's been everywhere? It's been an absurdity. How can you have a successful absurdity? Just drop the absurdity. So the Holy Spirit graciously continues to minimize my success here, which is, I'm sure, is a vast benefit. So I just accept and say, okay, that's great. Non-dualization is a tough boat to turn around. We have to turn it around. And the whole idea of success is so primary to us, and to realize we don't need to do anything at all. We don't need success. We don't need non-success. We don't need to be successful. We don't need to be failures. We simply don't need to do anything whatsoever to be what we already are. And the trick is that what we think we already are is this search. No, that's not what we already are. That's a silly, absurd, whimsical misadventure. That we think we're not what we are until we find what we are. No, there's no one searching and there's no finding. We are what we are right now. And so I know we have to keep hearing this. Keep hearing it, keep hearing it, keep hearing it, keep letting it sink in, sink in, sink in, sink in, sink in. It's just like, because then we say, wow, I don't need to do anything whatsoever. What does that do to my expectations? So we practice doing nothing whatsoever. Neither impressing the world by what we do, nor impressing ourselves by what we don't do. Neither one. And I could feel this fear. He's like, you know, really like shuddering of just, oh my gosh, oh my gosh, oh my gosh, what am I getting into? It's like a child getting into deeper and deeper areas of the pool. At some point they start saying, oh, each time they say, oh my gosh, what am I getting into? The parents are there around the pool, and the swim instructors, and if there's any trouble, say, don't worry, you know, we're in the pool. Okay, so you trust that. So right now, the chakra is so strong, my eyes close, so I'm not even really aware of the world right now, you see. Sometimes I'm really shocked with the eyes closed like this. But again, I don't want you meditating with your eyes closed, because that lends itself to being a poser. Because people, what they're doing is saying, well, I meditate with my eyes closed, so I must be really in a deep, deep meditative shock, you know, state of great breakthrough because my eyes are closed. This is, you know, lends itself to being a poser, very much so. So I always advocate, do your meditation with your eyes open. So keep your eyes open. This is what I advocate. That way it keeps you humble and lowly, because people think, oh, they're not really in a deep state because their eyes are open. And the eyes just look kind of normal. They're not in some sort of, you know, nirvikalpa samadhi or something. And, you know, okay, they're not really meditating very good at all. They're just sitting there. But when the shock becomes really strong, really strong, you might just close your eyes for a little while. I don't advocate keeping them closed too long, actually. If it's really strong, you know what to do, but then it gets difficult to open them. So I kind of half closed them. But again, what happens throughout history, the same old foolishness always crops up as people keep thinking, oh, that's a technique. Okay, my eyes are half open, so that's a... No, that's just a natural reaction to being wowed by a breakthrough and shocked. Oh my gosh. So don't do anything in particular unless it's just a natural reaction to your success, okay? Otherwise, just be normal. Just sit here with your eyes open like a just conventional, normal... normalcy. And so people look at you, they don't think you do anything at all. Just be like that. That's why I decry the yoga girl attitude in the world. It's disastrous. It's for fakers. It's for fakers, custom made for fakers, posers. And they teach everyone else how to be better posers, which then what happens? Makes the continuity fear extremely severe, and you become afraid of any spiritual breakthrough whatsoever. Intrinsically, it's the snake sneaks up on you. And before too long, you think, okay, time for a breakthrough. Ah, I'm so frightened. What happened? What happened? This is what occurs here. For sure, this is what occurs here. I went through that myself. I said, okay, time for the big breakthrough. And then this tsunami of dread rose. I said, whoa, where'd that come from? Continuity fear. Because you're raised in our society to be a world beater. You know, I was raised to be like a president or something, really. That the expectations on me was like, well, maybe you could be president someday. So I was always like feeling like I had to act like I was super confident, you know, and like presidential. Always tried to, you know, supposed to act presidential. Look, act like JFK. Come on, be presidential. Oh, you know, always know the answer. Know the answer right now. What's the answer? Oh yeah, the answer is this. What should I do? Well, this is what you should do. It's all bluff. You know, a lot of these bosses, they always have to act like they, you know exactly what to say and what to do. But what I would have said was, you know, hey, just stop. Stop all this. Just stop and sit quietly. But that wasn't allowed. Nobody taught me that. Meditation? Oh, yeah, okay, this is how you're going to meditate. Okay, sit this way. This is your posture. Your eyes are closed. You're breathing your breath. Watch your breath like this. Now say om and to say the mantras. That's all, what, accomplishment. Be confident. You know what's that? That's not it. That's the opposite. So the spiritual climate of the world is going in the wrong direction to a very large extent. Your path should be a natural outgrowth of your success, what you're doing. So when the wow wears off, my eyes are open, I feel, you know, okay, pretty normal. Now, you might see like some beautiful vista or beautiful graphic, And you just like, you may wow, and after a little while you just go, I just want to close my eyes. It's too much for me. I don't want to see it right now. It's just too much. And then a little while later, open them up again, or maybe just not look at it, because it's so beautiful. It just it stresses us out. We're overcome by great good news. Overcomes us more than bad news, doesn't it? It really does. Sure, it does. Somebody passed away, my cousin passed away. Almost nobody was overwhelmed by it there. I mean, they all kind of said, okay, well, that happens in life, and that's a, you know, tragedies, terrible, a lot of tragedies, a lot of terribleness happening. It's like people are so used to tragedies now that it just doesn't seem to faze them at all. But if they were to like win, you know, $500 million in the lotto or, you know, whatever, I don't know what great good fortune would be, they'd just be like freaking out, like, oh my gosh, and just stressed out like crazy. So we're way more stressed out by success than failure. Way more stressed out. If someone has come to you and said, guess what? I attained the rainbow body. Death. I'm finished with death completely. Yeah, they just say, oh my gosh, that is so unbelievably great. I guess can't handle that. But if you were to come and say, guess what? You know, a doctor says I've got cancer, maybe 6 months to live. And they just go, oh wow, okay, well, that's terrible, but let's see what we can do. Let's even get some treatment for that. And, you know, let's maximize your time. And they'll give you some advice, a little pep talk, right? But then they'll go on with their lives, right? But if you say, guess what? I'm now realized, I'm completely free and done with all illness, all sickness, all death. I'm perfect health forever. They just would say, oh, that's just such great news. I cannot handle this news at all. You gotta give me some bad news. Give me some bad news, please. So people, I find when I talk with people, I always have to give them some bad news because they can't handle my confidence. They start getting really nervous. Because I'm super positive, super positive, super positive. Okay, well, give me some bad news. Oh, well, okay. Hey, Lincecum, you know, it's really tough. Yeah. And then they feel comfortable because they're back into failure mode. Oh, great. So this is what I find, that people are extremely crippled in their ability to handle success. Extremely crippled. Real success. I don't mean business success. I mean real success. I don't mean being voted class president. I mean real success. Like, I see the way to be free of transmigration. Totally free of it. I see it. I see what it is. I can do this. It's very easy to do. Okay, that's real success. Now, those who have stalled out are always looking for figureheads to use. Because in their stall out, they've lost their a charisma in some way, right? They say, wow, what am I going to do now? I couldn't make it. Maybe it's impossible to make it. Maybe it's all just a fantasy. And I got hooked by the fantasy, but I didn't make it, and so I don't think I can ever make it. So how can I function? Because I stalled out. I failed. Well, I need to find some figurehead and use them to attract people, attract attention, and then benefit from that. This is what happens. And when they fail, they want to say, look, I know everything about the path and everything. I know this, I know everything. And I still failed, which means it's not my failure. It's just the path failed me. Because I did everything right. Because look how knowledgeable I am. So, but the path failed me. So I might be knowledgeable. I don't try to work on it. I work on a little bit, not too much. But what I'm working on is full stop on the wow. This is what I always emphasize. The other stuff is just shop talk. It's shop talk. Jesus always told me, don't quote chapter and verse. It's not for you. And he always said, go, forget it. And I said, but Jesus, I don't even know what anywhere any lesson is, what number it is, where, you know, the chapters, the paragraphs, where I can't find anything. If you said, you know, find this quote, you know, I wouldn't have a clue. Like, you know, like Bible people, you give them a quote, they say, oh yeah, I know what that is, you know. First Timothy, this, that, you know, they know where everything is, and you think, wow, they're so smart, they really, but I don't know where anything is in A Course in Miracles. Jesus said, that's great, that's what I'm looking for. Because you're getting the essence of it. You're getting the momentum out of it. So he said, just do that. Forget about being a teacher of the course. Forget about, you know, all that stuff. Just go. Faster. Urgency, urgent. Jesus emphasized this great urgency. So there must be something very urgent coming here. Knocked me out. Wow, had trouble with that. Okay, so probably a good time to wind it down. The message continues to be given out appropriately. Don't worry about being a chapter and verse superstar. Someone asked me some technical, I'm sure I see my, in my mind somewhere, I could probably, but it just doesn't, can't pull it out right now. I'm too shocked. So that's another thing. You don't seem like an expert when you're in the shock of the wow. You get kind of hazy about labels and details and stuff. It's not important. You saw the big picture, and the big picture knocks out the little picture. The little picture's not important. How do you spell bodhisattva? I don't know. Right now, I don't really know. This morning, I had trouble with figures. And because I was still really knocked out in the wow, so much so. I don't really care if, adding 10 and 5 and 6.5, blah, blah, blah. It adds up to something. I'm sure it adds up to something. But right now, I'm not having much success adding it up. I had some trouble. Usually I don't have trouble with that, but this morning I did. And, the idiots will say, oh, it's Alzheimer's, dementia, you're slowing down. No, it's this extreme wow. So how could we have a society when nobody even knows about this, the right spiritual practice? So they're going to give you the wrong advice 100% of the time. What kind of culture society is that? People wonder why I don't really love this world. Yeah, what's to love? You're getting all the wrong advice. It's a place where you come to get wrong advice, which builds momentum towards more transmigration. How can that be a good world? This is all the world does. Because that's how we use it. So it's an insane asylum. Insane asylum is where everybody gives you the wrong advice, and they think that they're giving you the right advice. And perish the thought that you suggest otherwise. That's an insane asylum. People in insane asylums get angry at one another. Because they say, I'm Napoleon, you're not treating me like Napoleon, I'm really furious with you. So if you don't accept the wrong advice in this world, people get very upset. They get very angry at you. So the best way is just don't look like a person that anyone would want to give advice to, because you're so lowly. And you say, I'm not going to waste my time giving you advice. What a waste of time. You're just a lowly knucklehead. Ah, thank you, Jesus. I am just a poor wayfaring stranger. Used to know that song. Used to know a lot of songs. Just a matter of, practicing all the time. When I was into music, I was into music 24/7. Always doing something musical. So I just used that sort of dedication and just transferred over to the spiritual path. Now I'm always doing something non-dual spiritual. Very similar. So, creative people can transition over the spiritual path. Certainly they can. So can business people. Everybody can. They just do the similar, very similar. Always have, an iron in the fire. A couple irons in the fire there. I always say the only time I take a break from spiritual practice is when I go to church. I get at least 1 hour out of the week where I take a break from it. Yeah, that's where everybody takes a break from it there. It says, folks, we're going to reward you from coming to church and helping us out here. I'm giving you a break from your spiritual practice for a while. So we know you'll appreciate that. We'll just fake it like you're having spiritual practice. We'll sing some songs and we'll call it good. Oh, everybody goes, thank you, this is great. And we'll talk to God about this, when we get to heaven, it's okay, we got the word from on high that this is okay. God, okays this. said, "Yeah, but I feel like I'm stalling out. You know, my life is stalling out. Is that okay?" "Oh, sure, it's okay. You know, you just keep coming here and support us and everything. That's fine. And you'll talk to God, really." "Yeah, but Jesus said that." Well, yeah, I know Jesus was kind of hardliner, you know, but his mom, she's a little more. She kind of has a more of a sympathy for you, you know. So she'll talk to God and tell Jesus, "Hey, Jesus, you know, tone it down. It's okay if they stall out. Stall, it's okay, you know. God said it's okay. It's okay with me, you know. It's okay with God, right?" And Jesus says, no, it's not okay." He says, "Well, Jesus, we gotta kind of, you know, temper you down. Don't worry, folks. I know Jesus is a hardliner, but his mother, oh, she's pretty easy to please. Okay, so it's for her, if you stall out a little bit, that's fine. That's fine. She understands." Where Jesus doesn't understand, she understands. The mother understands. "Father, he's too strict, huh?" "Yeah, but it's the Father, the strictness that gets you saved. And it's the leniency that gets you, just ends up building more momentum for transmigration." "Well, that's okay. I'll make sure you get a nice place in the next realm. Call it heaven. We'll call it heaven. Give you a nice place in that realm." "Yeah, but I'm still struggling with body and sensory perception and vulnerability and fear and scarcity and competition. I'm miserable." "Well, you know, get you into the next realm. But boy, I just came from one realm into this one." And you say, "What are you talking about? You're brand new, freshly minted." No. "I remember that. I've been going through these realms for so long." "Ah, you're crazy. You're crazy." No, I'm not crazy. I don't think it's okay to stall out like this." "Well, you don't love the mother?" Why? "Not the mother of transmigration, I don't. Why should we worship the mother of transmigration? The mother of search, then mother of search." You say, "Don't worry, I'll make sure you have a successful search." And Jesus is saying, "Call, you know, call up the search. There's no need to do anything whatsoever." "Oh, but that's so strict, so difficult." "Well, you know what? You know, it's difficult to have a good golf swing too. But if you work at work, 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 you know, it gets better, 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 better. Somebody, our pros, there's a lot of pros around. They did it somehow. I see some of these pros. I can't figure out how they do it. None of us can. It's ridiculous. It really is. Confidence is what they have. The difference between us and pros, confidence. But confidence, somehow they're able to wow of their great shots. You know, they're able to deal with it psychologically. It's their psyche that is so effective, really. It's very difficult. You hit a great shot in golfing and you come unglued. You hit a bad one, it's like, you know, but drop another ball to another one. But it's when you hit a great shot that you come unglued. You say, "Oh my gosh, I can do that? Well, how come I don't do it more often?" Well, whoa, and it starts freaking you out. So the pros can somehow handle their success. They've learned how to handle their success in golf, which is very difficult. They have a certain mental makeup. When I go through my mind like a round of golf, like I'm birdieing every hole, but then I get to the 18th hole and I'm shaking. Oh my gosh, oh my gosh, I can't. You know, I gotta screw up now. I can't finish it off strong. I mean, it becomes like a nightmare. Like, you know, you start shaking. Like, so I just sort of role play that in my mind. I can tell how am I doing with success? Can I handle success? At some point, you just say, "Oh, I don't want to, I don't want to build up these expectations for myself going forward. I don't want to find the self because then, you know, I might have to find, you know." The self will say, "Oh, so you can find me. I'm going to send you out again so you can find me again. You're getting real good at this." No. I want to be a failure at But there's no I to be a failure. It's nothing from the very beginning. How's that a failure? What can't be done is not a failure. What cannot be, can, impossibility is not a failure. There's neither success nor failure, just impossibility. Okay. So this is, we keep harping on this, but what's the number one thing? Full stop in the wild practice and recognizing what you're doing is you're allowing continuity, a smooth continuity between your shocked state and your normal functioning state. So you can allow these breakthroughs to happen just as you're going about your daily life, like I am. Just living in suburbs, working, doing everything everybody's got to do. You can allow the shocks to happen and still just keep on functioning. Nobody is any the wiser. And you're not losing face. There's no face to save. You're not losing face. Nobody pays any attention to me anyway. So I don't really worry about how do I look, how am I acting, and everything, because nobody cares. Nobody cares. That's true. Nobody cares. That's a great blessing. If everybody cares how you're feeling, that's a great burden, isn't it? Because you always got to try to act like, oh, I feel this way for you. Oh, good. But no, nobody cares. It's great. If you understand that it's God that's helping you for out with that. So this is the crux of what we're doing. This is the absolute crux, because the breakthroughs will come as long as you practice like this way. The breakthroughs will absolutely arise for you, just like for me. They absolutely just